sometimes the most loving thing you can do is say no, so you can say yes to the right things and unleash that peace and that joy that comes from a balanced, healthy life.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
I don't know about you, John, but my life is busy. Is yours?
Somewhat, yes. Never a dull moment.
You know, our world is fast-paced and keeping up. It takes constant effort just to stay on top of it all with work and family and errands and other obligations. I'm sure people in the audience are going, yep, check, check, check. Yeah. You know, finding margin can be a challenge, but it is crucial to do so. Jesus did it, of course. In Matthew 11:28, Jesus tells us, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." What a wonderful promise that is. Yeah. Today, we want to give you some tools to help you simplify your life by cutting out distractions and making wise choices. Who wants to do that? I see your hand.
Sign me up. Well, we have Kevin Harney with us. He's the founder of Organic Outreach International and also serves as the lead pastor at Shoreline Church in Monterey, California. He's married to Sherry. They have 3 married sons, 3 grandchildren, and Kevin sounds busy and is. He's learned, though, how to prioritize the important things, and he's captured his insights in this book. No is a beautiful word, hope and help for the overcommitted and occasionally exhausted. Look for your copy on our website, click the link, or give us a call, 800, the letter A and the word family.
Kevin, welcome back to Focus.
It's a joy to be back here with both you and the whole team. You had an amazing team.
I believe you're right. I do believe we have a great team. Now, I'm so glad you didn't say no to being with us, so that's good. Yes. I guess margin was there for you flying out from California to say hi to us.
I have some automatic no's, but you guys are not one of them.
Now, the problem is no is such a hard word for us, especially in the Christian community. How do we use it effectively?
Yeah, great question. And I think that because we worship a Savior who's compassionate, who's loving, who, you know, when we say amen, so be it, so often he says, I love you, I'm going to, you know, God provides, he protects, and yet we're not all-powerful. We're not all-knowing. We can't do everything. We're bound by time and bound by space and bound by schedules, and especially those who have families. Once you have a family, your schedule just fills up in ways you never dreamed it would before.
That's so true. And it doesn't necessarily get easier as they get older.
My oldest son and his wife just had their first child, little Cal. He's only 9 weeks old, and their life has changed. And so just this process of saying no to certain things so you can say yes to the right things has really become a new part of their lives.
Mm-hmm. Now, balancing this, I mean, this is something you learn over years. Mm-hmm. I feel like I've done a lot better job. The older I get, I'm better at saying no. So I don't know if that's wisdom or just disgruntledness. Hopefully it's
combination.
Wisdom. Weariness. But balancing those priorities really came into play for you as a dad. I think you had something called Dad Home Night. Yeah. And what happened?
Yeah. Well, when we moved into our neighborhood that we lived in West Michigan, we had 11 boys under 11 years old the day we moved in. Not us, but the neighbor, the cul-de-sac, and other kids in the surrounding area. And when I'd go out and hang out with my boys, it would become an immediate neighborhood game time. And I love to play. I love to have fun with my boys. And this is when they were little, I'd go out. And at one point, my youngest son said, Dad, could we ever play with just you? And I thought, Nate, what a great, I said, yeah. He said, because every time we come out, the whole neighborhood comes. And I said, you know what? I said, we're gonna have times where it's kind of dad-son playtime. And so I told the neighborhood kids, hey, sometimes when you come over here, it's going to be the dad-son playtime. Sometimes it's going to be neighborhood playtime. So when I say it's dad-son playtime, you got to go away. And here was the amazing thing. They understood.
Yeah. They went home and said to their dads, hey, Dad, when are we going to have our playtime?
They might have, but what they understood was, so then they'd run over and they'd say, hey, is it your playtime with your boys or is it playtime for the neighborhood? And I'd say, it's going to be playtime with my boys. And they'd say, well, when's our turn? And I'd say, you know, an hour and a half. Or I'd say tomorrow. And that simple no transform my relationship with my boys because they realized that I was saying no to the neighborhood to say yes to them. And then we also had nights where I committed to be home, come home from work and not go back to work again.
Yeah.
And that was a whole nother realm of saying no to my work so that I could say yes to my boys.
Kevin, it's interesting because what you're tapping into is an example of prioritization.
Yes.
And it's so hard for us to do that at times. Yeah. You know, when you look at that, how do you prioritize? What's your inner circle? What's your next ring? What's your ring after that? How did you do that? And what were they?
Yeah, well, and I think that that for followers of Jesus, we start with the scriptures. And my boys have always known that my walk with Jesus and my commitment to him is actually more important to me, it sounds strange, than either their mom, my wife, or them. And then they also know that my relationship with my wife is more important to me, not maybe more important, but I told my boys—
Prioritize.
Told my boys, don't you ever try to get between me and your mom, because I've known her longer than I've known you.
And I'll know her longer, for a lot longer. I'll have to live with her a lot longer.
there's that too. And we just celebrated 38 years of marriage.
Oh, wonderful.
And so they get that picture. So just establishing and saying, okay, my faith is going to be— and so often we don't say no, it's our faith, our time with Jesus, the thing that gets bumped off the plate and kind of disappears. Then family, and you know, people say those things, faith and then family and then work, but oftentimes we don't live it out unless you establish those boundaries.
Well, and that was the reason for the question, because that was a very practical example of doing that, saying no to the neighborhood boys so you can have unique time with your own kids. I think that's a great example. You compare our schedules to a buffet line. You got my attention.
You're in. So you walk down the buffet line, and that maybe aren't as popular as they used to be, but when I was growing up, that was a big thing for the family to go to a buffet, because you could get whatever you wanted. They had all kinds of options. So you start walking down, you kind of, well, this looks nice, and how about that, and how about that? But the problem is, you get halfway down the line, and you go, oh, I'm out of space. And then you're either taking things off, which is kind of rude on the buffet to put something down to grab.
You don't do that.
So the visual is this. If your life is like a plate, and with your work and with your faith, with your family, with your free time, your personal hobbies, whatever it is, at some point, the plate gets full. And then if you slide something onto the plate, if it's truly full, something falls off. It's just the science of it. It's the mathematics. There's no space left. So everything you slide on, something falls off. What I began to discover in my life and the people I was watching is that people who couldn't say no kept sliding new things on and not intentionally taking off something less important. So what would happen is more important things would fall off the back of the plate. Usually the kids, the marriage, personal health, time with Jesus. And all of a sudden we're saying yes to things and we're accidentally saying no. I tell people, you say no all the time. Even the people say, I can never say no. I can't say no. I say, well, is your life full? Yeah. Is your plate full? Yeah. And then you're saying no all the time. Because every time you slip something new on the plate, something's falling off.
It sounds like intentionality. You say in the book, every yes is a no and every no is a yes. Yeah. I like that. I get it, but describe it in more detail.
Yeah, it's really revolutionary. And when I was sharing this with people for years before I wrote the book, because I was just trying to learn how to balance my life. And with all the things that I do and love, I had to balance it out. And so I began to look and realize that when your plate is full, and so when I explain to people, when your plate is full, when you say yes to something new, so I can jump into that men's softball league, and then I'm saying no to my going to my daughter's recital. If I say yes to this new commitment, I'm saying no to something. And so the opposite is true. If I want to really intentionally give guidance and boundaries to my life, I say yes to something, I know right now, saying yes to come and be with you two gentlemen and with your audience today, I said no to some things back in Monterey. That's just how life works. So I actually stop and think about those things. I had somebody ask me one time to do something, and I said, my plate is full. Give me 2 or 3 days and see if I can remove a few things to make room to do that. And that's the idea. When you say yes to something, you're going to be saying no to something else. But when you say no to something, you can say yes to something even better. Yeah. It's just deciding.
Well, and that leads to the other question, the power of saying no. Yeah. And how have you won at this within your own family? Do you have an example or two?
Oh, yeah. I mean, one of my, a life-changing moment for me was when we were away actually in Colorado with our boys on a little ski trip. They were probably maybe 6, 8, and 10, something like that. And so while we were away, I brought some work with me, which I shouldn't have done. I should have said no to it, but I brought some work and I was working on it. I went to my wife and I actually said, you know, I was reading this thing and it was this pastor was talking about how he blocks out 3 nights a week where he just doesn't go back to work. He makes sure that he's, you know, because they had like Sunday night services and they had Wednesday night family nights, but there's 3 nights a week he would come home and not go back to work. And I said to her, you know, if I am not careful, I could end up going back to work every night or working at home every night. And my wife very graciously said, you do. And I didn't know it. And I said, and so I very maturely said, no, I don't. And she said, I think you do. And very graciously.
Did not.
Yeah. Well, I turned into a 7-year-old. And so I said, I'm going to go get my schedule and show you. And I got my schedule and I had to turn back 3 weeks to find one night I hadn't brought work home or gone back to the office. And it broke my heart.
Yeah.
Because I had promised I would not become that kind of pastor or that kind of dad. And so I actually said to my boys and to my wife, I made a commitment, and to my congregation, I shared with them, 3 nights a week, I'm going to go home and I'm not going to go back to the church. I'm not going to do church work. My congregational members, they said, we agree. We don't want you to work 7 days a week. They weren't asking that of me. But here's the fun part. So the first night I walk in, and my son, Nate, my youngest son, jumps on my back. Dad, you're not going back to work. You're going to play with us the whole night. I said, I am, buddy. And we had a great night. That happened like 3 or 4 times in a row. And then about the 5th or 6th time I come home on a dad home night, I wait for Nate to jump on my back. He's not there. And I looked up on the, he was always standing on the washing machine. I said, Sherry, where's Nate? So he's playing with DJ. So where's Josh? So he's playing with their friend. Where's Zach? He's off with a friend. I said, don't they know it's a dad home night? And she said, oh, they said you're always here.
So right. Totally 180.
God redeemed it, right? Yeah. Because I just made those decisions. So I can tell you something. From that point on in our family life, I kept that rhythm. And my boys, they love the church. They're not bitter towards the church for taking their dad away.
Wow, so many pastors need to hear that.
I know.
And so many professionals. I mean, same thing. Kevin, let me ask you, are all no's the same? And what does the menu of no's look like?
Yeah, so in the book, one of the fun things about this book is that because I was just doing it for myself, some of the chapters are a paragraph long. Some are 3 or 4 paragraphs. Some of the chapters are 2 or 3 pages. I think the longest chapter is 3 pages long. It's 68 chapters long. But one of the things is a section is called Know Your No's. And I go through all these different kinds of no's. And they're very different. I have a nuclear no. It's what I call no, never, I'm offended you asked me, don't ever ask me again. That's my nuclear no. If somebody comes to me and asks me to do something immoral or illegal, I don't say, oh, no, thanks. I need to find the right words to say, you know what? That's not who I am. And you don't ever have to ask me that again because that's against my character.
That's a good parenting tool.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And teach your kids nuclear no.
Yeah. And there's times where, and I have. But then sometimes there's a no where somebody asks you to do something and you go, you know what? I'm not the best person for that. No, but I know a guy. But I know a woman who can help you with that. So that I have a no that's no, but I know someone. And you pass off the no, you know, the opportunity to someone else. There's a no, but maybe another time, and you keep the door open. There's all kinds of ways to say no. And once you learn them and you have a menu, then when a situation comes, you go, okay, which of the no's am I going to use? And I find in most circumstances, you can find 2 or 3 or 4. And I tell people, make up your own no's. And then I tell them, know your no's. And I tell them, pick your no's and pick them wisely.
N-O apostrophe S.
Know your no's and then choose or pick your no's. And then don't feel bad when you say no, because you're saying yes to something better.
I love the balance that you're bringing to this topic. Yeah, yeah. Kevin Harney is our guest on Focus on the Family. We're talking about his book. No is a beautiful word. And I hope you'll contact us to get your copy. The link is on the screen, or call 800, the letter A in the word family.
Kevin, let me come back to that nuclear no. It may not be in that category, but something happened for you in that way at 13.
Yeah.
What decision was that? And I think this is a great parenting example.
Yeah, yeah. And this is one that's become an automatic no. I don't ever consider saying yes to this one. So let me tell you what happened. At 13, my dad's mom sat me down, my granny, and I loved my granny. She was one of the, in an extended family of over 100 people, one of the only Christians in my whole kind of atheistic, agnostic family. And she sat me down and she said, Kevin, your dad, my son, Terry, is an alcoholic. And she said, he's very functional. He's very successful in what he does. But she said, he's controlled by alcohol. She said, my first husband, his dad, died in a gutter as a drunk. She gave me the family history, and his father. And she looked at me with tears in her eyes, and she said, don't be the next generation of men in this family who is controlled by alcohol. Will you promise me you'll never drink? I said, it's too late. I was already drinking and already smoking marijuana. And I said, but I promise I'll never do it again. And so from that day, I have never, at a wedding, a toast with champagne, not even a sip, I just made the decision. And I made the decision that is an automatic, absolute no for me.
Kevin, let me talk to you about a parenting tool that I've actually expressed in some of the books I've written, The Good Dad and other resources. Many of us as parents, we want to try to say yes to our kids more than we say no, because we can get into a rhythm of saying no to our kids. Yeah. And I just wanted to offer you that opportunity to differentiate between kind of the scheduling no, where you get overcommitted, your plate is full, and how in parenting the yes-no decisions that you make. Fill me in on that.
Yeah, so I talk about saying no to the no monster. Don't become the no monster. Don't become that parent that says no to everything, that's so kind of controlling and overcautious. So Sherry and I, when our boys were young, we agreed that we would say yes as often as we could so we could bank away those no's that we really needed to speak.
It's a great strategy.
Yeah. And so one of our boys came to us and said, I don't like my bed. I just want to have a mattress on the floor. And I don't like wearing a sleeping suit with a little pocket, like the
sleeping suit.
Pajamas. Yeah, I don't like wearing pajamas. Can I just sleep on a mattress on the floor with a blanket and just like some boxer shorts or something? And so Sherry and I had a conversation. I said, Sherry, because Sherry's a little bit more, she grew up in a little bit more structured home than I did. And I said, honey, this is a yes. This is not a big deal. I said, we don't have rodents on the floor. It's not unclean, you know? And so we said, yes. And within a few months, all three of our boys were in mattresses on the floor. And they thought that was kind of cool. And so we stored away the
wood frames.
The wood frames, that. Right? But it was one of those things where when we did say no, they knew we meant it. But they knew we would try to say yes anytime we could.
Hey,
but,
Kevin, let me ask you too. You write about a little change you made when you're checking out at the store. I think this is a great application for just Christian worldview. What is it and why did it change you?
So it's more like at Christmas time for about 6 or 8 weeks, I realized everywhere I was going, it would be like, you know, it'd be the Salvation Army bell ringer. It would be the, hey, can we round up your bill for food for hungry kids? Could we, you know, do you want to give a dollar towards this? And I was getting so irritated. I was just like, can I just buy a dinner and not round up my bill? Can I just go? And I found myself having a crummy attitude. And I finally thought, you know what? I'm just going to say yes every single time.
I mean, it's 43 cents.
Exactly. and if mine was, you know, if what I'm buying is $5.93, it's 7 cents. Right. And so I thought, I'm going to not only say yes, I'm going to say yes really enthusiastically. Because I watch their faces. They're like, do you want? And they're so used to no's. And they don't want to be asking this question, but their work makes them do it. So I basically made this decision. And so since that time, this was years ago, I'll look at people. I'll say, yes, I'd love to. And some people are like, they're startled. They're like, whoa. And they'll say, I have an enemy say yes all day. Hmm. And it brings a smile to their face. And here's what I figured out that first Christmas time, at the end of Christmas, I went back and I figured out it was like $25 or $35 altogether.
For the year?
For the whole Christmas season. And I made like 20 or 30 people happy that I said yes. And I was less cranky because I knew I'd have an automatic. So that's one of those ones where at the end of the book, I go to kind of the yeses and how it frees. I'm not going to say no to these things unless they're asking me to give towards something that I don't support.
Yeah, we're right at the end, and I think this has been great. It's a good reminder for us in our own self-discipline to remember to say no so that we don't have to push other things off the plate.
Yeah.
And to say yes to our kids as much as we can when it comes to involvement, engagement, time spent with them, et cetera. I'm thinking of a mom who maybe volunteers at school. Mm-hmm. It sounds a little bit like my wife, Jean, when we had the kids in school. Maybe church too, and runs her kids everywhere because they're in soccer or this or that. Mm-hmm. Or the dad who's trying to get ahead at work, so he's working a bit late like you were. Yeah. They say yes to a lot, and it costs them. What's the Christian thing to do? What would you say to them at the end of the program? And how could they get on better footing and move toward a more confident no?
Yeah. Well, I would say, you know your no's. Come up with lots of different no's. And I actually tell people, practice saying no. Go in your bathroom, close the door and say, no, no, thank you, no. And just practice different tones and get used to the word coming out of your mouth, right?
And don't do this around your spouse.
Yeah, no. But I tell people, saying no is a great act of love. Hmm. If you could understand that. I'll tell you one last short little story. I was in a restaurant with one of my sons, and there was a mom with another son about my son's age, and the son was just out of control. Just out of control. And everyone in the restaurant was kind of watching because it was just really kind of not a pretty sight. And as I'm watching this, I looked at my son and realized that he was watching also. And he looked at me, he said, Dad, why doesn't that mommy love her son?
Mm.
And I said, buddy, what do you mean? He says, well, if she loved him, she wouldn't let him act that way.
Hmm. Wow.
If she loved him, he realized that the reason that I wouldn't let him act that way, the reason that Sherry and I have boundaries is because we love him. He understood that at a young age. And he realized that this mom didn't, he was like, she doesn't love her son enough to say no. Yeah. So I would say to that mom, sometimes the most loving thing you can do is say no, so you can say yes to the right things and unleash that peace and that joy that comes from a balanced, healthy life.
Yeah. Kevin, this has been so good. And I hope people will be encouraged and take some of these lessons away from the discussion today. And I just want to say thank you so much for taking the time and saying yes to being with us.
And you guys are an automatic yes to me. I love what you do here. I love your ministry. It is impacting people all over the world. And so to come alongside and do anything to help is a privilege. So thank you for the invitation.
Appreciate that. Let me remind our listeners, we're here for you. And if you're struggling in this area and your life is chaotic, because you're not finding God's shalom, his peace in your life, because you're saying yes to too much, get in touch with us. We have caring Christian counselors who can help you and discuss that issue with you, in addition to great resources, one of which is Kevin Harney's wonderful book, No is a Beautiful Word. And if you can participate with us in ministry, we don't pay shareholder dividends like the online people do. All the money that you send to Focus goes right back into ministry. So if you can make a gift of any amount, we'll send you a copy of Kevin's book as our way of saying thank you for being part of the ministry and helping others. And you can do that through a monthly pledge or a one-time gift. Either way, we'll send you a copy of the book.
Yeah, get in touch today. Donate as you can and get a copy of Kevin's book. Our number is 800, the letter A in the word family, 800-232-6459. Or click the link on your screen. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.